So comfy.
Yeah. Feel good? Ready? You all look great. All right, we'll just get started then. Hi, everybody. I don't think I need this mic at all. downwards. So, as you all know, this is the Asian American Student Union Past Presidents panel. We're really excited to invite out some former AASU presidents to come talk to you all about their experiences within their own student involvement and how it impacted their careers moving forward, and sort of share their experiences with you in hopes that you all will gain some insight, especially since, you know, it is the end of the year, and I know you all are thinking about what you want to do and what you want to accomplish in the next year, so hopefully they can inspire some ideas. But before we begin, let's get to know them a little bit. So if you all don't mind going down the line, briefly introducing yourself. If you want a mic, I can totally pass the mic down. But it all depends on you all.
I think we're good.
But yes.
Do you need the mic?
I'm good without
it. Okay, we're good without it.
Shall I start?
Yes, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Lin Wing. I served as the 2003-2004 AASU president. I'm currently in transition of kind of thinking about different career paths, but formerly served as the interim director of our Office of Multi-Ethnic Student Affairs, which is kind of equivalent to what MCDA is here. We function on a multicultural organization and part of a multicultural center work, but under the Division of Student Life. So I've been doing that for the last decade, entering the field as a multicultural affairs professional for the last 10 years, and now kind of pursuing some other paths and playing with freelance photography as a photographer as well, and a creative arts person. So playing with artistic world for a little bit as I think about how do I use some of the diversity education work that I do to create more change in the world. So that's where I am now.
Awesome. My name is Philip. I was AASU president in 2009 to 2010. After I graduated, I moved to Hawaii and I taught. I became a teacher, a math teacher, middle school and high school for 5 years. And after that, I moved to San Francisco, where I'm now finishing my master's in Asian American Studies. And so now I am looking to go back into higher ed to sort of do the type of work that Lynn does, and with a particular focus. An emphasis on Asian Americans, particularly in the South. That's what my thesis is on.
My name is Megan Vu. I was a president right after Philip, actually, in 2010, 2011. Michael Sadapur is actually my little, so I'm very proud of that. Anywho, I finished here at UF, and then I went off to med school in the faraway land of Orlando, Florida. I joined the Navy while I was in med school, and then they sent me to the very harsh environment of San Diego. And then afterwards, they let me go to Houston, Texas, to finish my general surgery training at Baylor College of Medicine. So that is where I'm at now and where I'll be for a while before I go back active duty once I finish.
Hey, everyone. I'm Michael Sadapur. I was AASU president from 2011 to 2012. Right now, I live in New York City, and I worked in media and technology. Worked at Nielsen, and I'm actually about to start a new job on Monday at Turner. And now you know. And I think that covers what. Yeah. Okay.
Are you keeping things
right? No, I'm not keeping. We just don't talk as much as we used to.
You're literally just finding out about your job right now.
What? Let's save this for later. Okay. Next. No, yes. But I would also like to point out this is in chronological order, and I'm surrounded by two doctors.
All right. Hi, guys. My name is Karamia Villanueva. Just going down the line, I was president right after Michael, 2013, right? 2012 to 2013. Afterwards, just kind of like Megan, I went to medical school in Tampa, USF. And then now I've kind of circled back. I'm back in Gainesville doing my residency in obstetrics and gynecology. So I've been actually driving. Actually, I drive around town and I like always, because if I get off at 5:30 or 6 o'clock p.m., I'm driving by the stadium and I always still see FSA practicing. And it just brings back good memories. So I do see you guys out there.
My name is Kayla Tran. I was president right after Karamia, 2013-14.
since graduating, I worked in Charlotte, North Carolina for 2 years, recently moved back to Florida in Jacksonville, where I work in the finance banking industry.
Hi, everyone. My name is Narayan Kulkarni. I'm currently a first-year Master of Business Administration student at the University of South Florida College of Business. I was AASU president 2015 to 2016. So to give you like an idea of where that is relative to this timeline, when I was a freshman, Michael Sadapur was AKM's assistant executive director, and Kara Mia was AASU president. My first year on AASU board was conference chair. The next year, when Kayla Tran was president, and two years after that, I became AASU president. So since graduation, I did the Asian American Studies minor during my course of study at UF. After graduation, I completed a graduate certificate in health sciences at USF, and I'm in my current MBA program, and I wanted to take that in healthcare management.
Can you give our panelists a round of applause? Traveled from all over to come talk to you all, and we have to prepare some questions, but there is going to be a session at the end. If anybody does have some questions, you can write it down and you can bring it up later. But for now, we'll go into the moderated questions. There is, you know, a few, so we'll try to keep time, but if there is something that you all really want to say or add to a question, please let me know and we can stay on it. So.
Yeah, definitely cut us off if we go too long, because with this group.
No, just with him.
Well,
yeah, with me.
Take some time. All right, so maybe about 12-ish minutes per question, but if it's a really good question, we'll keep on it. We'll play it by ear. So for the first question, as we are the Asian American Student Union, what does the Asian American identity mean to you? If anyone can start, anyone can pick it up.
Okay, I guess I'll start. So the Asian American identity, so I identify as 1.5 generation Indian American. I moved to the US when I was 3 months old, and I moved to Florida when I was 6 years old. And immediately after that, 9/11 happened, and so I was immediately ostracized by many of my peers. So it was very uncomfortable for me to identify as Asian American. So that was a big formative part of my experience. But then it also meant me using my faith, Hinduism, as a way to learn about myself, to learn about values of community and things like that. And then when I came to UF, really seeing a bigger picture and a piece of belonging, which is especially championed by AKM, which Michael Sadapur was part of, and then by really great leaders like Kara Mia and Kayla, who really helped me understand that like there is like a sense of care and compassion to be a part of. And then when I was in AASU week as a freshman, Lynn, Megan, Michael, and Kara Mia were on a similar panel to this one, and they instilled in me a sense of legacy. So being an Asian American means a sense of legacy, being a part of people who do great things, and people that are really striving to become the best version of who they can be.
Dang, that's good.
I can go off of that, and I think you had mentioned, yeah, in 2013 when we did a similar panel, you saw everyone between me and Philip, as well as a few before me. And so this is quite an honor to return and see kind of the next generation of leaders. And so I think for me, as the Asian American identity means everything, right? So it's a social identity, it's a political identity, it's a racial identity, it's a cultural identity, right? That really connects me to a host of individuals who have gone before me, right? Generations and generations. I myself am a 1.5 generation immigrant, came to this country on a boat with my family from Vietnam. And so having a legacy and an understanding of what struggle meant, and definitely someone who grew up here in the country, in the U.S., but have worked my whole entire life and been doing a lot of things. So I think the connectedness when I came to college of what does it mean to develop who I am and explore this identity of being Vietnamese American but Asian American, right? Connection to a whole bunch of people and stories and access to different resources I had never fathomed to be, yeah, I like how you put that, Narayan, the best version of myself. What did that look like? Who am I? That's the work I do now in multicultural affairs or have been in the last decade. But yeah, that it connects you to something, right? Many of us, especially Asian Americans, come from a very collectivistic community and identity and that we are one part of many pieces. Very much true for who I am as an individual. But yeah, feeling like there's people I can connect to, right, who have similar and different experiences than my own, and that our goal is to actually progress as a community together, whatever that means. Yeah.
For me, my identity didn't really start, my Asian American identity didn't really start until I got to UF. I grew up in Lakeland, Florida, Polk County, where, you know, I was, you know, the only Asian student in my school until my sister was born. And then, you know, then there were two of us. And then, you know, growing up in sort of that environment, you just didn't really know that you were Asian. You knew that you were different, but you didn't really call yourself Asian American. You were just different. I mean, I think at one point I was just calling myself just pure Chinese, you know, until I went to China and realized I was not, like, pure Chinese, that I was actually American. I had, like, that American side of me, too. And so coming to UF, being in ASU, really helped me understand my own Asian American identity. After I left Florida, I think that really strengthened my identity as an Asian American, but then also gave me the understanding that there were also different types of Asian Americans throughout this country. So, for example, you know, I moved to Hawaii, and you know, all of the Asian and Asian Americans who live in Hawaii did not identify with the things that I had gone through. And similarly in California, that my cousins who grew up in California, they went to high schools where, you know, 50% of the student body population was Asian, right? And so it's still very different from what I grew up in. And so in my program, I study a lot of history. And so for me, I think what has really always kept me coming back to Florida is really understanding what does it mean to be Asian American in general, but what does it mean to be an Asian American in Florida? And that's sort of like where my research has taken me, that, you know, I think that our history is there, that there is a history of Asians in the South, you know, that goes as far back as the 1850s, you know, but nobody knows that, right? That the orange that we eat today, you know, was cultivated by a Chinese man in the 1910, you know, in the 1920s, right? That nobody really knows, you know, where he was the one that developed a frost-proof citrus, you know, and his name was Lu Kim Gong. And I asked those questions, why don't we learn that in elementary school, you know, just as much as we learn about Thomas Jefferson, you know, especially since it pertains to Florida history. And so for me, my identity has evolved, but I think really strengthened for me to return back to Florida to sort of reclaim and demand that I have that history of who I am, particularly being an Asian American in the South, in the U.S. South.
Okay. So this is a very interesting question, and I actually think is one out of the questions that I previewed, one of the hardest to answer, I think, because it's the most open-ended. It's interesting because what you've noticed is that everyone has a slightly different, there's no like standard definition, right? You can't look up like Asian American identity in a dictionary and find like a standardized answer. It's a very personal thing, one. Two, I think there's a lot of like historical context to it. So there's stuff that like that's out there, like Philip said, that we don't know. But then there's also this element that even the concept of like a unified Asian American identity is probably like something around like 50 years old, give or take. So it's still like a relatively new concept. Like if you ask your parents or grandparents, like the concept of like a unified like Asian or Asian American identity is like a relatively newer concept. And so I think what also makes that interesting, to like tie it back together, is that, yeah, there's a ton of like historical points that most of us don't know. But the second thing is, identity is like one of the most important things and something that we probably ask ourselves the least about. And what makes it interesting is because there's not, the narrative hasn't been like set or formed and it never will be, we have like a great opportunity to sort of partake and help craft it. So in my mind, what does that mean? That means that when we go to, you know, whether it's a job or career, if we're one of the only Asian American people there, or we have opportunities to do something outside of like traditional mainstream fields, or whatever we do, we're in a lot of ways sort of an ambassador, whether you think about it or not, to your community. And so for me, what that means is like, hey, you know, there are gonna be situations where I don't feel comfortable to like step up or to speak up or to volunteer to do something, but I don't wanna propagate that notion if I'm sort of representing the collective, whether or not the collective wanted me to. And so it's sort of just it's always in the back of my head that like, hey, I'm not just speaking for myself, I'm like subtly speaking for others and others are subtly speaking for me. So I think of identity as like, hey, we're all part of this broader tapestry. It's something that we're still figuring out. but it's most important that we think of how we can define it and build the story together.
I mean, I really don't have much to add to what has already been said. You know, I would honestly say ditto to everything that has already been said. I think what's most important about the Asian American identity is that it's personal for each person. I think my identity kind of began similarly to Phillip's, where, yes, you know, like, we have a collective experience of how, you know, we may have been isolated in our hometowns in Florida because the population of Asian Americans is just not large in certain areas, but then when we come together here at UF, there's something very special and meaningful about having shared collective experiences together. And so, you know, I think in general we have common experiences, but at the same time we have to figure that identity for ourselves. Do we still flyer? Okay. I feel like that was probably like my first exposure to just like Asian American community is like it is Turlington, right?
Yeah, it's
okay, I don't know. My memory. It was just like,
it's full of medical. It's full of medical facts.
It's full of medical facts.
I'm like your external hard drive of knowledge.
No, so I mean, like, I remember Turlington is, like, what has, like, one of the busiest, like, foot traffic, even busier than Disney. But, like, you know, there's so many people out there flyering. And I think there were just flyers about, like, you know, come join this AASU meeting. And I was like, Asian American, what does that mean? And then, you know, it's just always, like, a friend of a friend of a friend says, hey, you know, why don't we go to this thing together? I can't remember if I went to an FSA meeting first or an AASU meeting first, but literally just being flyered was that ticket to getting involved with this community, which has opened like incredible doors and everything like that. But that was probably the most initial thing that I can think of being exposed to AASU.
That's a good one.
I went to ASA and I saw a Viet chick standing up there who was president of ASU. I was like, that's badass. Yeah, that's when I got involved. But then I went to VSO. So I'm Vietnamese American. My family, like my mom and my dad met at UF. I was born in Gainesville. Mike Doe likes to say I'm an ACR. I didn't grow up here. It's okay. But yeah, I was born in Gainesville. I like bleed orange and blue. You can check. You know, my mom was really involved with the Vietnamese student organization. She started like all these trips that are still apparently going on, which is really cool. So I knew when I got here I would definitely join VSO. My little cousin actually, oh my God, I should call him. But my little cousin's actually part of VSO now. It's just, I knew I would join VSO. Mike Doe took me under his wing. He's right over there. He's my big brother.
Me too.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And then I'm the favorite.
Yeah, that's fair.
Okay. So between all of that, I got plugged in and I was excited about it. And, you know, speaking to identity, this was the first place where I really kind of started to explore that. Not just being, you know, one of two Vietnamese kids or Asian American kids at my largely white Catholic school where the Vu family doubled the population when my sister went to school there. That's like the same story. I went to ASA. I saw Tao standing up there being a badass, and I was like, that's really cool. I want to do that.
I was like, who was that?
Yeah, it was Tao. Yeah.
So, like I mentioned in the first question, there was a feeling of being left out and misunderstood, but there was a feeling of belonging. And so my involvement in really trials of transition from that. So when I went into college, I heard a lot of really good things about like UF and the chance to get to meet people and the chance to get to know people. And so I also am, in general, someone who likes to explore and innovate. So there was one time where I literally went to SAI when they were having an open house, and I met the two co-historians of CASA at that time, Bach, Chen Huang, and Vien Phan. And then later that day, I was invited by Elizabeth Wong, who later became CASA president, to a CASA Big Little event. And I was immediately welcomed as a good friend, and I was like, wow, this is the Asian American community here. They're people who really welcome me. Further more, at AASA, the theme was vocalized. And as someone who had been silenced, I was like, these are people of all kinds of Asian American backgrounds. They're really putting their voice up. I remember a particularly poignant moment where Karamina, Kayla, and the rest of their e-board, they all came up and they were like, we are AASU e-board, this is our voice. And I was like, wow. I was just like enthralled by the whole thing and like all the dances and everything. I was just like, this is like the place to be, man. And so I got involved in all the events, and I was like, I just wanted to look and see opportunities for that. And then I'm gonna go to Michael now. So as AKM assistant director at that time, like I met Michael randomly at like the SAI office. Like I said, I like to talk to people, and he was like, you know what, you should come to AKM's opening ceremony, it's a really cool thing. And then I was like, okay. And so I went to AKM's opening ceremony, which is themed Illuminate. So that's shedding light on the Asian American experience, shedding light on your own identity. Again, very inspired. And then later on, so you know this rights, correct? This is a multi-year project that it takes to build. And so with that, they had student panels and student get-togethers for students to give input into the architect. So I was one of a few freshmen that was recommended to attend that panel. I believe Kara Mia and Leah Villanueva, who was the API director, I later found this out, but they suggested that I go to that panel. And so I shared my perspective, and I was like, wow, this is an Asian American community that's really making waves, and they're really having an impact. And so I was like, I want to get really involved. And so that led to involvement in, say, AASU and things like that. And then I also got exposed to APIA affairs at that time because I went to, again, trying to be that cool, that kid who just like did everything and like explored. I went to a reading group hosted by someone called Leonie Barkan, who then became a leader for me in the campus awareness team of APIA affairs. And so I just want to give a quick aside that I brought some like relics. So this is the very first ASU shirt that I ever got.
Those are relics.
That's our shirt, man.
Yeah, so I got this as like a discount. Bro. This was when I went and like met Bach and Vien. That's the very first exposure I had to ASU people. This is the AASU program when I went to like Columbia. I was a travel scholarship at that time. And then like this it, and then like I mentioned earlier, a panel like this one really inspired me. This is the flyer for that mini conference panel that like really inspired me. So I have all like these things. So I've kept these to this day as like motivators for me. And so I'm gonna pass this around if you want to take a look at some of this.
Yeah.
What? Someone said it.
Just don't mess it up. Don't mess it up. We're gonna archive.
Nostalgia.
These are more things. So yeah. So in short, exploration of being inspired really led me to be involved.
Well, I've recently done the opposite of what Narayan has done. We did a purge, as I've got rid of a lot of things. But I do have some relics myself. If you ever want to see them. But yeah, I think my entryway was also very similar. Of initially, really trying to make friends, right? You come to college, and you're like, dang, who looks like me? Who? I had more than two people who were Asian American in high school. It was a large Vietnamese community, but I wasn't really a part of it. So I came here going, what is this Vietnamese American? And then I learn what is this Asian American. So I entered through VSO and did, you know, the celebrations and emceed and kind of got out of my box, did some dancing here and there. But my root of kind of the social activism of Asian American issues really started with the AASU. I think it was my sophomore year. I was, one of 12 or 13 who drove up to D.C. For AASU, and myself and my vice president at the time, Mark Villegas, were just walking through, you know, that big pillar is where MLK gave his speech. I can't think of the name right now. But we're walking through, and we were like, you know what? What would it be to start a revolution? If those who know Mark, it was always about revolution. So he was really the person in my mind with me and my leadership who was like, Lynn, let's just kind of mess up the system. How about you and I run for president and vice president and just do something different? And so my year, when we moved, this was a transition from what, when we called ourselves the Asian Student Union, which is what I inherited, became president of, and then kind of that second year, Mark and I were like, but Asian Student Union doesn't represent me and you. And so we started that year, and then Mark entered the first year being called the Asian American Student Union, but really wanting to reflect our identity a bit more. But yeah, sitting at AASU in D.C. in the cold, because we're Floridians going to the cold, had to wear jackets. We're like, what do we do? And so this notion of how can we create change as leaders and say, hey, let's just do it. So I came back and ran as president my sophomore year, somehow people voted me yes, and I ran against former leadership later on, Dennis and others. And yeah, just really kind of found a voice for myself as someone who was relatively shy, but really wanted to do something for my community. And so learned that I can influence people and can do something, and that when I lead, people follow. And it was kind of humbling to have amazing leadership on my executive team to really do some good work while we were here. So yeah, it's kind of entered through BSO and AASU, and those kinds of things really helped me get involved.
When I think about the history of ASU, I came in 2006, and I similarly entered through CASA, was very involved in the social aspect. But then when I started to uncover, I think, what was left behind by my predecessors, and, I started to see that, I would see pictures of Lynn and, all the people who came before her. They were the ones picketing in Turlington for Asian American studies, for ethnic studies, and I sort of realized that, I'm part of this lineage, and that I felt really compelled and motivated and inspired to continue that. That what we have today, for example, she and her class started, and I'm sure that before her time, we started in 1993, right? And even to become the Asian Student Union in 93 was a lot of work. And so, for those 10 years, and then the transition into Asian American Student Union, I think, was a lot of work too. Lynn really inspired us our year to really push forward for the Asian American Studies, which is now a minor, right? Mm-hmm. For the Association of Asian Alumni, to be officially recognized by the Alumni Association, and then for me, just knowing that I had that lineage, my specialty was archiving. And really making sure that generations after us wouldn't have to go digging for it, that that it would be officially part of the university, that we are recognized, and yeah, so that sort of the legacy that I think that we all have shared here.
Okay, so freshman year, 2008, I was very busy on campus, and I remember getting some flyers for ASA and CASA, and then also it would surface up on Facebook the way that it was structured back then. And for whatever reason, I just never had a chance to go. And so the first year went by, summer came around, and I again started hearing about ASA, and I was like, I definitely have to go check this out. So it was in one of the old ballrooms of the Rights Union. And I remember I got there late, which was obviously a big mistake. And so there was no room to sit. And so I was standing in the back, and I was like, man, I've never seen anything like this before. I don't really know what's going on. But I was like, this is cool. And then after that, there were open chair positions on Philip's board for an alumni chair, sports chair, and a community service chair. And I was like, you know what? If I do this, I definitely want to do something that's going to have a meaningful impact and give me an opportunity for leadership. And first ASU meeting of the year in that fall of 2009 was in the Graham area on that second floor.
That's right.
I don't know if you ever still have meetings there.
It's blue.
Yeah.
It's blue color.
And
Graham Hall.
And I remember going in, and Philip was standing at the door with Vanessa. And I remember Philip and I shook hands.
I remember the very moment he came up to me and said, hi, I'm Michael Satterpour, and I'm interested in working on your board.
Yeah.
I was like, all right.
Do I need to move?
Welcome.
I can move.
Welcome.
Now you can sit for now. And I think that's the singular of all the things I did in college, and I probably did more things than I should have done. It was the most singular turning point of my college career and beyond. So I applied for alumni chair, didn't expect anything. We interviewed in the food court on a Sunday.
Yeah.
And then I remember I opened my Samsung flip phone. And I
flip phone.
Yeah, I had a flip phone. And yeah, it was really cool. Anyways, and then I had this voicemail, and it was like, hey, this is Philip. We want to add you on. I was like, this is awesome. And that was how I entered into ASU, and the rest is history. Yeah.
And actually, one more thing. His year, we sat in front of the board of the Alumni Association pitching, you know, why the Asian American community deserved an official recognition by the Alumni Association. Because by that time, there was the Association of Hispanic Alumni and the Association of Black Alumni. And we were, you know, we brought such compelling arguments and evidence that there should be an Association of Asian Alumni. They were literally finished our presentation and they were just silent because they were really, they're just like, we have no reason to tell you no. And so the next year we became officially recognized.
And we did the 1-2 punch where we had you do the opening I did middle and then you closed them out. That's always the key.
Yeah.
And it was a 50-page proposal. I used census stats and I stayed up all night 2 days before to finish it.
It's a very large proposal.
Yeah. So. That was good. Yeah. That's good. Oh, that's happy about it.
For me, I also had a very badass Vietnamese president, Megan, down there.
You never told me this.
Well, you're finding out a lot of things.
I'm finding out so many things.
Yeah, you know how I feel. But also, you know, like everyone, I don't know if you guys are familiar with EACASU, but that's East Coast Asian American Student Union Conference, where it's a national conference for, you know, students like us, to meet and talk about identity and whatnot. And then got me started in FLP, Freshman Leadership Program. From there, yeah, like you said, it's all history.
Let's see.
I'm here, right? I'm the
you got caught up in it too.
Moderator, really awesome. Being able to hear all these stories. So as you became involved in the Asian American community, you made your way up, of course, to being AASU president. And so for the next question, what specific projects or campaigns did you work on as AASU president? Any specific initiatives or ideas that you had and that you worked on through your presidency, or even before your presidency, anything that was really meaningful to your heart, we'd love to hear about it.
Should we start from the beginning?
Yeah, so 2003 was the 10-year mark of the Asian Student Union, and so, yeah, I think one of the first things as we came out of EACASU was a name change, right? So explored that as soon as we started our leadership, Mark, myself, and my board. And then when we went to EACASU, one of the other pieces was realizing there wasn't a network of Southeast Asian Americans, so we started CIRCLE. So if I know, I think maybe rotating now. I was back a few years ago, but CIRCLE, and that name was born in La Casita because I was a senior, well, actually I was a junior, and I visited friends in La Casita. But yeah, we were there trying to create what name would work, and you should have seen us trying to create what name would make sense, and Mark was so set on CIRCLE. And I was like, but people are going to pronounce it CIRCLE. And then we just had all these different iterations of it. So if you've seen, you all's logo is way cooler than our logo. We were very limited in our graphic abilities. But it was me and Mark creating this, you know, sunburst thingy at the time. But our first director was Sandy, was the president a few years later. But yeah, CIRCLE, so this notion of, we were always traveling to the East Coast to get there, right? And multiple trips up to there, but really wanting to find some area here and thinking about the Southeast and Georgia and Alabama, all of our other schools here. And so seeing that going has been really cool. Yeah, so those were two of the things. And then I think at the time, I wasn't very much into politics, but knew that building a connection with student government was really important. And so it was intentional for myself and my leadership team to really know how student government works, particularly around the budget. And so made buddies with the senator who ran the budget committee so that we can get more money. So I think that's one of the things I was proud of and got a really large increase for us that year, which was really awesome. And then Asian American Studies, the proposal. So the pictures you see of us on Turlington, that was us. I think we made some of those cardboards. But again, that was really the genius and mind of Mark, who was really active-minded. I was the person to kind of make things happen, who would have the idea, and we would work together to figure out how things would happen. But yeah, we wrote a really long proposal, Mark and our leadership team at the time, to really fight for and think about Asian American Studies in the curriculum. We went before the faculty board and Senate to make our presentation. And they heard it, but it was a few years before it got established under Sandy with a certificate program and a variety of other things. Yeah, and I think the last thing I was really connected to, as you all heard, my senior year, I chose not to be actively holding leadership in Asian American Student Union, became an ambassador at La Casita, and so started to build some bridges there with our Hispanic and Latino community, and led some kind of cross leadership conferences with the HSA at the time. So those are some among the few things, and I think what I want to say after that, I mean, I think when the question for me is hard to think about what did I do under my presidency, but as someone who's very collectivistic, it's what my board did, and all the people who were involved in the ASU and ASU and all the sub-boards at the time, the work we accomplished was really was as a community, and I was just fortunate to be in the leadership role to make some things happen.
Mark, who couldn't be here today, he's actually a professor of Asian American Studies now on the East Coast, and he got his PhD in
Pennsylvania.
I think from UC Irvine.
UC Irvine.
Yeah. Going off of Lynn's budget increase, that our year, I think before that, the ASU president and the treasurer would be the one sort of like defending the budget, and so I really wanted to turn that around, and I said, we need to show the budget committee how large we actually are. And so I actually requested that each subword president and treasurer show up with a ton of their members, and actually there are people waiting standing outside of the room, and I think that the budget committee was so overwhelmed, that's why they doubled our budget.
That's what happened to us. So the room was so packed, we had so many people out the door, and so we got like 20% increase.
Yeah.
Minor that we got wherever you all started.
And so I'm not sure what it was back then. It was probably around 30,000.
It was in the 20s.
20,000?
Yeah. Where were you?
Now, like 150?
We're like
I know, y'all have ridiculous amount of money.
122,000
roughly.
Yeah, 122,45.
Okay, y'all have to know how much privilege and act that, I mean, that's immense. I ran an office of multicultural affairs with way less programming money than that, so
you were,
know that is a lot of money and a lot of privilege, but that's amazing.
I'm just going to give a shout out, Tony Law's right there, he's the ASU treasurer. It was kind of fun because I was, we're going to get to this part, but I was in Student Senate, and I went, I ended up on the budget committee.
Yes.
Yeah. Just saying,
what's wrong
friends
with you?
In high places, guys.
Okay, but continue.
Wait, so you were at what?
So we went from
20 to 41 or something, 20 to 40. Tony, how much was it?
You have to adjust for inflation to really get a true sense of the numbers.
It was very significant. I don't remember
the
budgets.
Yeah.
And I think at that time we had combined AKM and ASU.
Yeah, that's so why that made a difference because ours was separate. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I like to think of it in real terms. Like, how many Honda Civics could you buy?
Five.
Yeah, exactly. You could buy five Honda Civics.
Yeah. So the budget thing, you know, was one thing. And then the Alumni Association, I think, was something that I just, Michael and I continued throughout. We've been working on it for the last 10 years.
It's like eight.
8 years. That was something that we pushed. And then as we graduated and became alumni, we were like, we need to continue this. And so we're here today, and we still have a lot of work to do. We are giving out our very first scholarship, the first Association of Asian Alumni Scholarship that was influenced by Mr. Mike Doe over there.
Our largest benefactor.
He, back in, I think, 2008 and 9 was like, we need a scholarship. And I was like, I agree, but we just don't have any money. And so, you know, we still don't have very much money, but we have enough to give out our first scholarship. That's very exciting. So as we, you know, as we look forward, move forward, we hope that in the next 5 years or so, we can get $30,000 to start an endowment in which, you know, it continually invests so that we can use that money for you all, you know, for the students. So that's still my goal today.
I should have thought about this question.
We can come back to you.
Yeah, just come back to me.
Any of you?
Okay, I'll talk about some. So I don't know if I necessarily did any projects myself, kind of like what Lynn had mentioned, being someone who is like a good leader and inspiring others to do projects, but I'm just gonna kind of go down the line because these are some, in some ways inspired by these alumni, some of the projects that I really worked on. So I've learned about Lynn's work in Asian American Studies, and I actually contacted her external vice president, Teresa Haranila, in my junior year to do a revamped version of an event that they did called What's Why Not White Studies, event called What's Your Story, in my junior year. And so we brought like representatives of major ethnic studies programs to do a panel and share why that was important. And then how that relates to senior year was that I really spent some time, I was on a student interviewer for the new first director of executive director of MCDA, who is Dr. Foster, and then also for the new VP of Student Affairs, who's Dr. Parrott, and then I was also part of the MLK steering committee, which is something that Michael Sadapur did when he was like back in UF. He was part of the MLK steering committee at that time as well. So like I really tried to bring some of those things back and really put ASU back on that map. From Philip, I really understood the importance of archiving, and so I put in the description of the archivist, you know what, like, why don't you do archivist summits where you bring all the archivists for a universal discussion? Why don't you look into reopening the archives? Why don't you really think about making sure that you do like event evaluations? And so our archivist was Becca Kim, who is currently HEAL president, and she did an amazing job with her work as an archivist. That's like, I didn't do much work, but she did. I just set the expectation that she really ran with it and like exceeded expectations beyond everything else. From especially like Kara Mia and Kayla, they were very strong IDPs, and I learned from them the importance of like emotional intelligence being very systematic. And with that, like there's been a move to like make Unity Conference kind of be like a retreat style thing in the fall. So like I did a Unity retreat immediately after I was elected, partly out of necessity since we didn't have an ASU board, but that's something that I believe has been like adopted more and more. So like it's a less like more relaxed, more fun, rather than a very uptight, serious type of event. And then that's also the year when Sparks became an ASU program. So I really set like solid expectations and DTRing with Sparks magazine. And so like I really got them onto the ASU wavelength. And then I think that with all of these, and then with Megan, like Megan was someone who's very vocal and an amazing example of someone who uses her voice in order to like vocalize what her story is, and like making sure that like you're a strong advocate for a cause you believe in. And I took inspiration from, and also someone who networked with like Asian American students, Asian American communities across the nation. So I took that and I was like, and then when Kayla was on board, she really started with getting Asian American students in many different universities in Florida together in what's now called FASU. And so FASU has now moved to a structure where they have three executive board members called the trifecta, and I played a key role in coordinating the interview and the transition of those trifectas. So I was that conduit and going between. And then Kayla was also key in making sure Circle got there. And so Stephanie, who's between Kayla and I, she went ahead and she really made sure that Circle was handed off to the traveling conference that like Lynn and their board started. And so I just really like made sure there was communication from ASU as an organization to Circle as an independent entity. So I really set the tone in redefining that relationship. So in that way, I just really wanted to show that. And also, like, I had an opportunity to go to Tokyo and share my Asian American story there. And so, like, I really vocalized my Asian American story, again, especially inspired by Megan and her, like, amazing, like, voice and her use of that, as well as, like, in general, like, these are amazing trailblazing leaders who are very in touch with their Asian American identity. So I really tried to pay forward a lot of the legacy that I gained from what they had done so that, like, the next year had the capacity to really redefine ASU. And it's particularly meaningful because the end of my senior year was the opening of the new rights. And so I saw that like Kevin Doan, who came after me, and Ian, like these two amazing leaders are at the forefront of a new age, so to speak, of ASU, and a new place for ASU and Asian Americans on this campus.
I had a megaphone, so that helped. I don't know, there's like so many memories, this is going to be very scattered. But even just walking in, I was telling Tony, I was like walking in and seeing the auditorium in the back of the riots and stuff, I was like, I remember standing there in my aoyai, MLK, it was an MLK candlelight vigil thing, and we're reading excerpts of MLK speeches. It was so powerful, but I was just
not speaking like a little Vietnamese girl. I was speaking, I don't know, I just felt like MLK like flow through me or whatever, and I just heard some chick in the front go like, "Damn girl, get it." And I was just like, yeah.
That was me.
It was not you. I saw who it was, and it wasn't you. Okay, but I did bring props, so I don't know if those are relics. I really don't know what these are. Yeah, and Michael did call me old today, so whatever. Yeah, but here, if you guys want to pass this around, this is the very first Ink magazine. Go ahead.
I'll share a little bit about this. Yeah. So this is Pre-Sparks. And this was spring of 2009, and I actually was living with, she was the secretary of ASU back then, Amy Chow, and we had this conversation. She said, "Philip, I think, you know, I'm really inspired to want to start like this magazine." And I said, "Yeah, let's do it, you know, and let's start this magazine." And so we worked for a whole year. I think our initial goal was to publish like four magazines in a year. Actually, it took one whole year to just publish this, from, you know, the graphics to the stories to the printing to the fundraising and everything. It took a whole year. And after that, she's like, "I'm done. I'm tired." That's why it's just, you know, volume one and the end.
There's limited no editions.
It was my very last semester. Literally, it was like 2 weeks before I was leaving Gainesville. The founder of Sparks magazine, Kavina Lee, she was a freshman at that time, and she pulled me aside and she said, "Hey, I know you're leaving soon. I just want to, you know, talk to you about the magazine that you and your friends created." And I was like, "Yeah, let's talk about it." And so she opens her copy and she is like all marked up, and she's like, "This is what I would change." And I was like, "Oh yeah, me too. I changed this." Too many pictures. And so she literally had, like, you know, marked every page about what she liked, what she didn't like. And she's like, "You know, I'm just really inspired that I wanna kinda continue this and make it even better." I was like, "You do that." I was like, I would love for you to take this and, you know, build upon it. And then I left, right? I went to study abroad, and then I went to Hawaii, and she did, you know? And that evolved into Sparks Magazine, which is now beyond UF, right? And so I think that, thank you for bringing this.
Yeah.
Please take a look at it, and it's...
There's this really great picture of Johnny Lee. Oh, wait, no, none of you guys know him. Never mind. It's not that funny anymore. Okay, but this one is particularly great because, one, it has a picture of Philip in college, and then, two, it has this big thing where I, like, spew about how we need to renovate the Rights Union, and the Rights Union has been renovated.
So Megan was part of the steering... Actually, I was, Megan was, Michael was, too. We're all part of the steering committee for pre-Rights Union expansion. And we made sure that the dance rooms were gonna be in this new building, so.
Yeah, no, that was a really good experience too. It's I don't know about what your steering committees were made of, but it was mostly like these, you know, old white dude like VPs, and then like I. But I mean, it was good. They sent us to, they sent us to Georgia to look at UGA's student union. They sent us to Ohio State to look at their recently renovated student union. And we, you know, took elements of that and talked about what we wanted here. I spent a lot of time kind of explaining to them why multicultural space was important. You'd think that that's not something that you'd have to... There were a lot of things that you'd think you wouldn't have to explain, but there was a lot of explaining. But I remember very early on, I made a whole... I wouldn't call it a manifesto, but it was just like a one-page like sheet of like, these are the things that we want. Because they weren't used to us asking for what we wanted. One thing was Asian, Asian American Studies. Another thing, the Alumni Association. Another thing was space. I spent a lot of time on space. Another thing was having a director. All these things that you would think are, I shouldn't say that. It isn't a given that you should have these resources, but that's the thing, though. You should. You're a student here. You should absolutely have those resources. And it just, like Mike Doe kept asked me if I was going to cry when we were upstairs, and I almost did. But it really does feel very good to see that you guys have those resources now. And it really warms my heart. Like,
this is the stuff that we fought for all the time. As much as I love yapping into a megaphone, it's just, like, it really was all for that. But I just, my involvement, like, yes, it began because I thought, you know, there was some cool chick at ASA, but it really started, I went to Circle, got really inspired, and then I joined ASU as EVP, and I served as EVP twice in a row, and then I was president. But while I was EVP, I was also one of pretty involved with student government.
What's the inside joke?
Henry's EVP, and you want him to be EVP again?
Ah. Yeah, no, I did it twice. People thought it was weird, but it's okay. So I was just like super involved, and you know, and I was friends with like the HSA president and yada yada. So that was kind of helpful. But not only that, like I'd say the biggest thing, a lot of the things I did in Student Senate, now that I'm thinking about it, we're probably more, like I kind of forgot that I was on the budget committee. But that was just like one of the things that I did. Like the thing is like, raise your hand if you've gone to a student government, student senate meeting. Raise your hand. Okay. Can somebody, well, I mean, you guys can, I'm gonna pick on you. I'm sorry. Okay, or Mike, you can say just what would you describe a student senate meeting like? How much? How interested are the student senators in what's going on?
Not very.
They're not, right? They're not. I'm not saying I don't know what's going on now. I just it bothered me to no end. I worked my ass off to like. I'm sorry, I cursed. I worked really hard. I worked really hard to get elected. And then I got elected, and then I realized everybody just does their freaking homework while these students are standing up there saying that there's so many problems, like racism, sexual harassment, and budget. Budget cuts was, like, the biggest thing. So for me, budget cuts was the biggest thing. And they had this whole laundry list of things. So, like, you know, the state of Florida says, okay, we're gonna cut education by this many percent. That's just some little blip on some news article, but for you, if you go here, which you guys do, it's a state school, right? So that means something to you. That means dollars out of this school's pocket. That means they have to cut something. That means they have to fire somebody.
Yeah, in context that particular year. So the state of Florida cut their education bill by, I think, in excess of $13 million across the state. And so UF being the premier institution that year, we were at risk for not only our club budgets to be cut, but all our languages and our programs. Like, basically, we went to meetings where our professors were there too, because they were fighting for their jobs as well. That was like a really rough year for the state, that particular year. But was it under you or Philip, our budget stayed the same or actually increased? Whereas they slashed like whole programs and things like that year.
So
when you become an adult, like it becomes real, like you guys are students and things like that. And how she basically described student government meetings, that's kind of like what a board meeting is basically in the real world. Yeah. So get used to that.
I would actually counter that you shouldn't get used to that, and you should be the rowdy, angry Asian person. Okay, you don't have to be angry, but I was pretty angry. I was very angry because I don't know why I just clicked on this link where they listed all of the things that they were cutting, but I was just scrolling. I don't know, like, you're on the internet and there's memes. And then you're scrolling and then you see, like, okay, they're cutting whatever, food, uniforms, whatever. And then it says Vietnamese and Korean language programs. We're just going to get rid of those. Just, they're done. And I was, it really bothered me. It really bothered me. I did more investigation. We were the only program, as a Vietnamese American, it really bothered me. As my whole family went to UF, it was something I was really proud of that I was in Vietnamese class. My Vietnamese still sucks, unfortunately. It's not
because they cut it.
No, they didn't cut it. They didn't cut it. It's because
Vietnamese offered again.
No, it's fine. It's fine. It's okay. But no, I'm just a bad student because I was like trying to save it while I'm not studying. But it's okay. UF was the only university in Florida that offered it. And then she was up for tenure that year.
So we had a really strong case, and I got letters, and it went around Florida, actually, and I got, there's a bunch of Vietnamese-American communities around Florida, and we went to their thets and did things with them, so thank you, VSO. And then we would also ask for help and letters and stuff, and, you know, I got a bunch of support from the community throughout Florida, and then from just multiple levels kind of bringing that up, so that was good. Korean languages still got cut. Vietnamese language was saved. But those were just like an example of the budget thing. So another thing that they tried to cut multicultural diversity affairs, like the whole thing, the entire MCDA. Who uses the MCDA alumni or Asian spaces? Yeah, everybody, right? We didn't have those spaces, man. Like, we didn't have, there was no Asian space.
No, we functioned in the tiny room in the old La Casita that no longer exists, is when we did our organizing. And you all, I mean, your paperwork, we had, like, paper, and I was, you know, stapling with the borrowed stapler from La Casita to do our magazines,
yeah.
Right?
So, yeah. So we didn't have a space. We got, in our time we got a space, but yeah. I mean it was at Peabody. It was like it was okay.
It was a room.
It was a room.
It was a
I mean,
room
it was
like
a,
in the attic.
It was.
But it was.
It
not,
was a space.
I mean, like, at the time it was like yeah. Oh, we have a space.
Yeah, and it was exciting, but it was like, you know. But this is much better. This is much better. But yeah, I mean when they tried to cut that, I mean we went all out, man. We did sit-ins, which, you know, we're Asian, so we did a study-in. I literally marched down, like, across the campus with, like, a giant mass of people. I did a really angry speech in between La Casita and IBC, and I fist-pumped in the air. It was, like, really exciting time. I'm totally digressing, but it was just, you know, it's okay to be angry, just, like, you know, and use it constructively, I guess is what I'm...
But she makes Megan makes a really good point because of the political climate right now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. These are things that can repeat themselves with every election cycle, and because we're a public institution, like with the swing of like a pen and things like that, budgets, whole organizations can be cut. So just be aware of that. That's something that, you know, can come up and will come up in the upcoming years.
I know you're young, but you care about things, and you're learning about the things that you care about, and you should stand up for them, especially now. Because if you don't learn to stand up for them now, I'm not saying you won't, but you should learn how. You should learn how to stand up for them now, especially with, you know, this community. Just even the people in this room. Like, if you guys just sat together and thought of one thing you wanted to change about this university, you could do it. You guys could do it. You would kill it.
So Megan touched upon, you know, being angry and using that voice to foster change. And I'm looking at a former APRA director, Alex, who's looking around. Alex became APRA director during my presidency. And it was around this time ago, 4 years ago, where there were racist flyers around campus, where it was like a picture of a dog. And I don't remember the specific words, but they were about Asian connotation of like dog food. And there's like a prank number or whatever. And so it spread all over campus. I mean, literally around Little Hall, like near Wright's, like everywhere. And it was just, it created a really hot, for me, I was like, I thought that I came to, like, as AASU president, I was like, I felt really safe on campus. But in the moment, I didn't feel safe. So that kind of goes to Mike's point about, you know, like the political climate right now. And I remember feeling not safe or not welcomed by, you know, who put this up? Like, is it my peers or is it this person sitting next to me? So from, like, Alex and I, at that point, we worked together to mobilize the community. We were speaking with, like, the Gainesville Sheriff's Office, like MCDA. We got the attention of the Vice President of Student Affairs, you know, President Manchin at the time. It was a big deal. We hosted a forum like either that day or the next day. We were hosting interviews with like we had alligator articles. I don't save things like that because I'm not I like to throw things away. But you know, the whole gamut, and it was the perfect example of grassroots organization because you were so upset. And I think at that point it was a really great point in our relationship. Between APIA and AASU, how we can work together, especially how to create relationships with the university and our resources to create change and to raise our voices.
So I was writing thinking on the plane, like, what were the accomplishments and projects that we did? And there were so many things, and I, like, couldn't even remember some of them. And it's not to, like, brag or anything. It's because we had such a legitimately strong team. We called it the ASU Dream Team.
Do you call it that?
No, we called it the Dream Team. Whatever.
You came up with all the nicknames, Mike.
I did. That was the ASU Legends team was your year, and then we had the Dream Team. Anyways, back to the point. So I remember I was treasurer when Megan was president. I was alumni chair when Philip was president. And there had been, like, the expectation, just to give you context, of the whole year that basically I'd be, like, the next president. And so when the time came around, I was actually, like, second-guessing it because I was, like, really nervous because I felt like there had been so much done up to that point that I was really worried that I wasn't going to live up to it or that I was kind of going to bungle it. And I think we all know that ASU kind of goes in cycles. There's, like, high points and low points. And we were right at the timing where there should be a low point because we had had, like, two-ish good, two, three good years. And so that timing just says that I would be the year to drop it. And I was like, man, I talked to our mentors and advisors at the time. And I was like, hey, you know, like, there's a lot of expectation. I'm supposed to be doing this, but I'm really worried. And I don't know if I can handle the pressure that I'm going to put on myself because I think we all put a ton of pressure on ourselves. That's, like, a common theme. And they were like, well, whatever. We talked about it, and I decided, like, hey, I'm just going to give it my best. And even if I can do nothing else, people always knew that I cared. And they knew I cared about them. They knew I cared about what we did and whether or not we agreed or not. They always knew that, like, I genuinely was consistent. I always cared. And so I was like, okay, if that's all I can do, then that's all I can do. And I was like, you know, I'm not going to be comfortable unless I have a really good team to work with. And so I think I called or texted Karamia, and I was like, hey, Karamia, will you run for vice president with me? And so Karamia and I talked it out. Karamia was pre-med, so she wasn't sure either. And I talked to the rest of our board, so to fill in the EVP and the VPE and treasurer and secretary. So I basically recruited a board.
We handpicked your board.
We handpicked our board. I mean, they still had to run. But they all won. And that was key because honestly, I knew that whatever we could do or whatever we couldn't do would be limited or enabled by the team we had. And we had a very legitimately solid team. And once I was there, I felt so much more comfortable. And I always take a long view. So I had a keen sense that, you know, there was 1 year, but really that 1 year was 8 months. And out of those 8 months, it really flies by because you think you have all this time, but then you get through AKM, you get through your first round of meeting, or you get through ASA, you get through your first round of meetings, and then it's AKM, and then all of a sudden it's like Thanksgiving and it's exams, and then you're like halfway through. And I was like, hey, you know, they always say that people don't remember what you did or what you say, they just remember how you made them feel. But I was like, no. In addition to that, that's great, but I want to make sure that we have a tangible set of concrete accomplishments that we can point back to, and there are going to be some things that we're going to be able to check them off and do, and there are going to be other things where I'm only going to be able to help push the ball to a certain point, but as long as we push it as far as we can and let the next group pick it up, that'll be enough. And so at a tactical level, there are tons of interesting things. I went into the ASU archives. I found out that ASU used to bring speakers. So we talked about it, and we had ASA bring back a speaker. And that's evolved. We created ASU Olympics. We, you know, picked and selected the first alumni board. We pushed forward the minor so that could be set up for the next year.
We had a new director. Just the new position itself. I guess I'll take it for now. Yeah. So I mean, what's really incredible about just sitting in this panel is seeing the past about those ideas and seeing the present and seeing where it's come from and then where did I fit in the middle. So I would say that I'm not necessarily a creative person. I think I'm like more logistical minded. Obviously I went into medicine, so I have to see things a little bit more concrete. So I was like, so what am I going to bring to the table? Like, well, how am I going to create something new? And then I realized there didn't need to be anything new except take the momentum that had already been built and keep building upon it. So, you know, yes, there was Circle going on, ICASU, the budget. I think the budget by our time time was like at least six figures. And then it was like, okay, how do we keep building on top of this? So it was just so much growth and so much expansion, and it was just about how to essentially, you know, keep that going and capitalizing on it. So yeah, we had Leah Villanueva as our first like API director, and just even API director, and just figuring out, so what's her role and what does it mean to have this office? We had the space in Peabody, and we're saying, okay, we're going to have a new rights union, and like, where, you know, how do we get someone on the that committee to talk about, you know, spaces for us and the dance, you know, the dance rooms as well as, you know, it was an incredible fight. And like, yes, we were talking about the alumni association that had just gotten, I remember I was president, and we were just picking the first new board to run the alumni, and that was a little bit rocky, but you know, look where it's come from now. So you know, all these little things that happen over the years do build up into something incredible, and you know, even tangible. Like, look at the space that we're in now. Like, I don't even, what is this room? I've never been in this room before. You know, like,
where are we?
Yeah, like, where are we? Like, you know, if you've ever seen, are there like old schematics of like the old, like, what is it, rights union?
Like pictures.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, you know, like, all of this is brand new, and just to see. Just to see tangible spaces that, you know, I guess like my memories and the memories that I'm creating right now is just incredible. I'm actually really interested. Well, I'm sorry I wasn't here earlier, but I feel like I'm interested to see like the students' perspective and like hear about what's happening right now.
Yeah, you missed that.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm sleeping. I got off at 8:30 a.m. this morning.
We can all talk more after. But yeah. So, like Jeremia said, we, like, had a good list of things that we set out in the beginning, and we're like, this is what we're going to do, and, like, let's measure progress against it. Let's make sure it's measurable. It's probably, but then I had, like, my own goals, and so my own goals were, hey, I'm not going to let ASU dip. So my personal goal that I told them from day one was, A, I want to be as replaceable as possible, so I don't want you to miss me, and I don't want you to notice when I'm gone. And they're always like, that's depressing. But I said, that's... But I was like, there's a reason, because if the group is so reliant on one person to carry it through, then it's going to crater when that person is gone. And the second thing was, I was like, my goal for you as the e-board is that by the end of this year, all five of you are going to be capable of being president if you choose. No matter where you start from, no matter how quickly you progress throughout this year, each of you is going to be prepared to be ASU president and comfortable at the end of it. And then C, this is going to be fun, and I'm going to make sure that we don't get burned out. And I think that by that measure of success, we knocked it out of the park. We killed it. We absolutely crushed it. And ASU
dream team.
And ASU continued a successful path for the next few years, and it's continued that. And I think we haven't seen that dip yet, and it's been great. And the last thing is, I remember I created this Google Doc, and I gave it to Karamia about all the things I wanted to see for ASU in the next 5 to 10 years.
Yeah, 5 to 10 years.
And I also did this exercise where I was like, let's visualize.
We did this a lot.
Yeah. And literally the stuff, what we're doing right now in the room that you're in and all the resources you have, you are literally living the things that we could only have dreamed of. And there were things that we wanted to do. And I said, you know, this is something that could be doable one day if these other things are done. And yeah, so the possibilities of what you can do now with a clear vision, it's unlimited. Sky's the limit.
I want to kind of go off the theme of possibilities and I have a few trivia questions prepared for you all. So I'm just gonna, and this is relevant. So number one, of the there are 25 people that have held the position of ASU president up to and including IN. If you know the answer to this, don't say anything. What percent identify as female? What percent identify as female? Make a guess. Someone shout something out.
40.
More.
50.
60.
Close. 56% identify as women. If you go to the number of years where ASU has had a female identified leader, it's more than that. So the point is, in our greater society, like, like
women rock.
Yeah, like that have like oppressed women in our greater society in the majority of human history. Like that's a big discourse. But this is a space for things like feminism, inclusive like language, like inclusive discourse to occur. Like women rock in this organization. Women like are amazing people in this organization. I respect the strong, amazing women that have done great things in this organization. And so, like, that's one thing to really think. And if you self-identify as a woman, please take that to heart. Like, people respect you and, like, really move that momentum forward. Another question. Of the probably hundreds of e-board members that have been there, how many e-board members identified as South Asian? Make a guess.
It's like 2%.
Give me, like, an actual number. Two, more than two. Close. Less than that.
Yeah, it was like 8%.
Very close. Four. Wow. Four. So Nilofer Barwani, who was a secretary, followed by Shama Shah, who was treasurer. Yeah. Then me, I'm the only president who identifies as South Asian in all of ASU. And then Roni Dastidar, who was EDP, like the year before. And so I saw like a low representation of South Asians. And so that manifested in me doing a workshop at Circle, which you all probably saw through that, like, than what I gave, and then like presenting my Asian American story at like the Goy Peace Foundation Forum in Tokyo. And my last fun fact, how many Greek organizations have someone like, okay, so X number of Greek organizations have had a charter member of their class, so one of their founding line members as president. What is X?
Like as Asian president?
What's the question?
Okay, so how many Asian interest Greek organizations on this campus have a founding member that was also an ASU president?
One.
More than that.
Two.
So more specifically, Alpha Kappa Delta Phi Sorority Incorporated, Vanessa Kwong, co-president with Philip, and then Pi Alpha Psi, Dennis Nin, who came 2 years after Lin Nguyen, Kappa Phi Lambda, their second class, their alpha class, that was Tao Tran, and Sandy Chu. So the point there is, like, Greek organizations were something that were envisioned at Lin's time and before that. And that is, like, a place that many people find home. And so, like, this is something to keep in mind. Like, the idea of doing tangible things, that visioning process that Michael described has gone to Lin's time and beyond that. And we're seeing, like, the upgrading and the bringing to fruition of those things. So I hope that those, like, fun facts really give you perspective on the power of some respective groups and the real power that there has been in bringing things tangibly to this organization.
Yeah, that's awesome. Wow. Thanks, Ryan. And to add to that a bit, you know, the Asian American Kaleidoscope also had South Asian leadership under Sathish's year as the Kaleidoscope director, and myself, and Preeti, who also did. And so there were a few in our class really thinking about the integration of multiple identities of South Asian identity and the experiences related to our community. So, yeah, but thank you for that. It's awesome.
No, wow. Thank you so much. I did allow a little bit more conversation because you all were thinking about good points, and I think you also, you know, between sharing the stories amongst yourselves and with us, you did answer the fourth question. What did you hope for the community after you had graduated? And so in the interest of time, I'll go ahead. It's the last question, and if you could say in a few words, you know, how does your experience, or how did your experience as an Asian American student leader influence where your life is today? How do you use your experiences, I guess, in your everyday life? Hard to keep brief, I know, but if you could, it'd be awesome.
Lynn?
Well, I've run quite a bit, so I'd love to defer kind of to the middle there, perhaps. You all want to start?
Well, I'm in the process of, like, searching for a new opportunity job-wise. So right now, I've had enough years of experience where I have that, like negotiation power. And so sometimes at work, you know, the company will make you feel as if you... Oh, I have to keep this brief. But the company will make you feel, like, make you feel undermined, and at the same time, I have to take a step back. I'm like, is it because of my Asian American identity? I'm also a woman. Like, are they like equal pay? You know, like all these different things that we learn through ASU and in our experience. And so it's helped me to know my self-worth and value. So I'm actually also in kind of the same shoes as Michael. I'm like leaving an opportunity because I know that I have more value elsewhere. So that's kind of my answer to this question.
Okay, so I can answer this. I got this one. All right. So I think that ASU, like I said, was the most valuable experience I had. One, because in no other place out of 1,000 organizations on campus could I find a group of people that cared so much. I was in student government too, and it is like what Megan said and what Mike said. And I think there's something super, super special about ASU that you got to cherish, or I at least cherish, because I can think of no other organization that 6 or 7 people will come back on a Saturday flying from all parts of the country to do this, to just share.
And 4 or 5 of which do it twice in like a span of 10 years.
Yeah. And it's because we had such a great experience, and we want you to have that same experience. And how did that help me now? Like I said, ASU presidency was my favorite position I ever had. I said it on the last day at the last speech that even my worst day of ASU president was one of my best days of college. And it was because of you. It was because I knew we were creating tangible change. I knew we were having an impact. And I knew we were creating a legacy. And the best legacies you leave aren't statues or monuments or anything like that. It's the impression that you leave on each other. And I think that that's what it comes down to, you know, lifelong friends. We are legitimately friends. In the crowd.
You're like validating. Like, yes, we
are. Yeah, I'm telling myself. I have friends. But in all seriousness, yeah. It's in my mind. But in the crowd, on the table, like these are some of my lifelong friends, and I know we'll be lifelong friends no matter how much time or distance comes between us. And it's helped me in my career because it gave me confidence. It gave me confidence that I can speak in front of a group, that I can mentor and train and manage other people, that I can work with a lot of people who have different viewpoints or may not agree with me. And rather than say, well, we don't agree on 100% of things, we can't work together, it's like, hey, we probably have 60% of things we can agree on, let's figure out how we can get that done. And so I think it was an invaluable leadership experience no matter what field or career you choose. And the tangible impact and just the people you meet, those are the most meaningful parts for me.
I think building on top of that, so yeah, I would agree. College, figuring out your Asian American identity, building the core relationships you're going to carry throughout the years has kind of strengthened like my confidence in who I am today. I mean, once you leave college, you know, kind of life hits you in the face that you could be alone out there, kind of doing your thing, doing the grind, working 80 hours a week, and which is a reality
80.
For myself. Yeah, 80. And that
80.
Is our cap. That's our cap, 80.
80.
But, you know, at the end of the day, no matter how I feel, no matter how stressed I feel or, like, you know, how I could be depressed, but you know, I always have my core group of friends. Some, you know, a lot of them are on this panel as well.
Yes, we're friends!
But, you know, like, I can always pick up a phone. I can always text Kayla, like, in 2 a.m. in the morning. Kayla, I can't believe that you're coming this weekend. You know, it's just creating these friendships now have definitely strengthened who I am today. And, you know, I can always rely back on them through difficult times. And I think that's one of the most valuable experiences that you can take out of college.
For me, my experience in ASU has really influenced my decision to pursue Asian American studies. To become a historian, to write, to uncover a lot of the history that is ours, but we don't know about it because no one else has done it or nobody else wants to do it. I want to share a little bit of my research just because I think you guys would find it really interesting. I'm writing my thesis on two guys who were from China and they studied at the University of Florida in 1915. In 1915, the student body population of Florida was not even 400 yet. And if you can imagine, you know, a Chinese man and a group of other just white men, I think that's extremely significant. This was at a time before women were at UF, way before African Americans came to UF, yet, you know, we don't know that. And our university doesn't really acknowledge that, right? Yet we have, you know, the portrait of the first black graduate here, right? And the first Chinese graduate was way before that time, right? And there is so much more to be uncovered. And so that's really influenced sort of the rest of my, I think, my life to be able to be the historian of Asian American history, particularly of Asian Americans in Florida?
I think for me, as you shared a little bit of where I work, and I don't know if I mentioned what institution I work at, but in the last 10 years, been at the University of Michigan, and ASU was the turning point of why I went from a pre-med major who studied the MCATs and did everything to going, hey, I think education is really the more of the space for me. And so ASU equipped me with the leadership skills, the public speaking skills, the interpersonal skills, communication, strategy, event planning, to really step into a graduate program to help me prepare for the field of higher education, and then directly in the last 10 years serving in our director role at Michigan, which is a large campus just like this. And I've been very privileged for the last 10 years to be working, continuing to be in some ways a college student, living in a college town for the last decade, and working with the Asian American student community. But as I alluded to, working cross-culturally with our Asian our Latino students, our Black students, our Arab students, our Muslim students, I'm really privileged to constantly in the last decade existing in a world where multiculturalism was just the way things were, right? I was the one office in the division of very many units who had an all people of color staff, right? And I was proud of them, like, yes, my staff are all non-white, yes. That meant something, right? But always constantly learning, and so the skills of shifting, right? What student government felt like, yeah, you were right, they were doing their freaking homework, and here am I struggling and, fighting for something that was really important to me. I hated those spaces, right? And then as we talked about all the changes that happened on campus, as an administrator, students hated me, right? So being on that side, but for me, where a lot of the skills I started here was this notion that I can do something bigger than me as an individual. So taking the identity of really being collectivistic and this idea that we float better together, right, as a whole community. And so inclusion and all of those things, and really fortunate to go to grad school and really deepen my knowledge of what inclusivity looks like on a college campus. How do I change systems of higher ed that is still really far behind? Right? Our systems here are really far behind. Kudos to what we have started here, because yeah, I was in the year where there was nothing. We didn't have a grad student, so it was me and my board. We did as much as we could, and then we started and built all the generations that came after. But we did that in partnership with all the other people who did care, right? And as I thought about transitioning into the leadership roles that I did in the last year, yeah, this exploration of what inclusion looks like, what does it mean? Thinking about who you are, what are the values that are important to you, that I really honed over the years to figure out what is the change I want to make, and that I have the ability to make an influence, even if it's small, and thinking about how do you not compare that to others, right? Sitting in here so humbly, see the amazing things all of us have done, and each of you, I'm sure, have done and continue to do. I think it started here, right? I am, like I said, as I think about, as I mentioned, kind of this transition, I'm at core a social justice educator, right? You can do that in any space, in any career, in any field. With the reality of our systems, we will be the one of only very many, right? Every space we enter, I was the first Vietnamese American in 2034 to be a director. That's just the reality we exist in. But I was sharing with some others, how do you think about how do you enter those spaces, and what's the framework you want to enter it? So a lot of my work in the last couple of years is thinking about how I can enter spaces and reclaim some of that space and think about it. Instead of saying people don't look like me, how do I actually build connections in order to create a community that actually is better and more inclusive? So I know that's me. That's the value I'm oriented toward, and then what are my actions and how do I align with that? It's kind of where I'm headed. And ASU started that for me. How do I continue to grow as a person?
Similarly, ASU started that exploration for me. As Mia described, I was a bio pre-med as my major, and then I did linguistics and Asian American studies as my minors out of interest. But as I went through the presidency, I really just discovered the importance of the translatability of a lot of those skills to a greater environment. I think the seed was actually sown when Kayla went as president. She encouraged board members to do small presentations on practical topics like money management, public speaking, things like that. It's something that Kayla said. That seed was sown when I was a sophomore, and so I was thinking about how can I practically apply some of this stuff. And so I looked at positive psychology lecture series. I looked at budget management, YouTube video. Just instead of randomly going, I looked at cat videos. These are the things that I would look at. Right. So to say. say, like, these people genuinely inspire you to do tangible things. So, like, I looked at them and I was like, okay, how did they use their experiences? And so that's how I went ahead and took it. And so I came across, like, concepts like emotional intelligence. I came across leadership, management, and, like, literature and things like that. And then I also realized that I'm very good at leading individuals, like, innovating, being very tangible. And so that led to, although I love that in a healthcare setting, I was like, being a doctor is maybe not necessarily the best path. I like to see things at a bigger picture, a systems level, and I'm very good with data, so healthcare administration is perhaps a better way for me to go. And so that's why I decided to do that pivot into the MBA program. And so that's where I am. And to give you a bit of perspective, I barely graduated with around a 3.1 from UF, and I have a 4 right now in my MBA program. So it was a huge jump in my grades, just because I was able to do that work of aligning, because I had the experience and the incredible inspiration from these. So keep in mind, like, I've listened to them in my freshman year, and like there's the seeds of their wisdom soaked into me over a really, really long amount of time. And it took a long amount of time for me to do that processing. So that drastic change comes, like, and, like you have to go ahead and, like, plant a seed and then, like, sow it for a long time. In that same way, like, my burgeoning process is, like, a seed of someone who wants to be a game changer and an innovator is hopefully going to come later. I see, like, the beginning of some type of growth right now. I've also really thought about personal development. And, like, so I'm someone who, I do creative visualization as a daily habit. I do meditation as a daily habit. With archiving, like, going back to what Philip taught me, I use Evernote as, like, a habit. I do daily reflections. I have, like, I've developed systems for my own personal development, which I've been using. I do, like, 7 points of gratitude every single day, things I'm grateful for. So, like, the point is, like, the AASU presidency and all of my experiences and the inspiration from those who are around me, my peers, those younger than I, like Becca, for example, who did amazing work as when I was AASU president, those like you all right now, sharing your stories right now, and I've gotten the chance to meet some of you on board and like who are not on board as like a fellow member. Like, I really thought about how I can use that to become the best person I can, because when I become the best person that I can, then I can thus benefit other people in the best way, and you create that positive spiral and that ripple effect. So that's really what the AASU presidency has done. It's allowed me to ask bigger questions, align with my passions, and bring the learning into a personal practice that helps me grow and help others grow and contribute.
It's easy to think of AASU as, or your sub-organization as an extracurricular. It's just something that we put on a resume. This is some position that I do. This is, you know, but just from what you've heard here, and I'm sure from what you've experienced already, it's more than that. It becomes a family. It becomes a community. It's a political identity. It's so much more. And it's a learning tool. The things that you learn here are extremely transferable into any field, like absolutely any field. We all do very different things. What you get out of it is what you put into it. You know, the more involved you become, the more you'll challenge yourself and the more things that you'll learn. You'll learn how to network. You'll learn how to be a leader. You'll learn how to empathize with people, emotional intelligence, all that stuff is, like, really actually very useful in anything. We work in a very interconnected world nowadays, and we work with each other often. This is going to be a bit repetitive for anybody who was in the small groups earlier, but my advice is just to live passionately. Like, whatever, right now in college, you're number one, finding yourself and growing up and seeing who you are. You're learning largely what you're passionate about, what you like and what you're interested in. And then those things can all converge in your career. Like, I highly recommend that they do, and then you end up just never working a day in your life. You just love what you do. I love doing surgery. Cutting people is awesome. But I love...
I second that.
Yeah, it's awesome. But, you know, I love spending time talking to them. I love spending time with the team. I love, like, teaching my students is, like the best thing ever. But learning how to be a good teacher... Probably it was before college, actually. I was a martial arts instructor. Very stereotypical. But then the managing a team, learning, you know, different people are motivated differently, you know, taking a small team of people to accomplish great things, like, that's
that's essential. It's really essential. And like the things you do in college, like it just shows you that things are possible. I didn't mention this, but one of the things that we did, you know, was even had international effects. We found out that Aramark was working with a company that trafficked women from Vietnam to Jordan, and then Aramark. Short story is Aramark no longer works with that company. But you can have an impact as a student. You can do anything, okay? As just from a practical example for me, since that's what the question was, I'm a surgery resident right now. I'm learning how to operate on people, but still I still take my passions into again, angry women. So I started an association of women surgeons because it's still disparate, you know, just like the business field, just like everywhere. So I started that, and then I also am taking my 2 years of research in surgery and using it instead for a global surgery time. So I'm taking the things I was passionate about in college with global health, the short-term mission trips. I want to do something sustainable, something, spend some time with the World Health Organization, things like that. And then some research on multicultural diversity and how socioeconomic status can play into health. But essentially, whatever field that you're in, you can take the things that you're passionate about and you can work them together. Like we all have very different fields, as you've heard, but we've all taken that, like all the skills that we've learned from ASU, and also our passions in ASU, to like hone it and put it into whatever career we're in. So everything is possible. It feels totally uphill right now because you just feel like you're looking out and there's like the world. But the thing is, that's a really exciting place to be. College is one of the most exciting. It's just like a scary place to be, but it's also one of the most exciting places to be. And the thing is, everybody sitting around you feels the same thing. And then also, like, we are all always available to talk to you. Like, we flew over here, drove over here to talk to you. So please, I mean, I'm speaking for me, for sure. I'm hoping. I think, yeah. But I'm sure all of us, any of us, would be happy to talk to you guys anytime.
Yeah, Karamia is the most accessible.
Yeah.
I mean, I hope what you guys are learning today is that, you know, as you're hearing us talk, is that, you know, to really just kind of self-reflect, be immersed and be present for what you're learning right now in college, whether it is your education, whether it is the life skills that you're learning, the relationships that you're building, and, you know, you're going to take whatever you learn into the future. It's going to happen naturally. Mm-hmm. And also kind of learn that whatever you do right now, no matter how small it is going to have an incredible impact in the future. You may not see it. You may not think like, oh, this one event that I created is going to have, you know, isn't going to be continuing on like 5-10 years from now, but it will. Yes. And, you know, I think just knowing that can kind of give you that self-confidence and kind of give you reassurance that what you're doing is impactful and meaningful.
You know, I challenge everybody in this room today, find a buddy and just sit down, like, you know, when you're at getting a bubble tea or studying or whatever, just take like 30 minutes or an hour or whatever and just like talk about what could be better about this university. Just think of one thing. Think of one thing. And at the next ASU meeting, talk about it. Well, I mean, you can have more time than that, but I mean, I really do challenge you to do that, because that's what I did every day. I was very angry, just think about something that it doesn't have to bother you. It just has to be something that you don't have to be as angry as me. You just have to find something that you think could be better, because there's always something that could be better in this world, right? We all want to help people. Just
think
of something.
One thing that has been unsaid, but I want to bring to light, is the importance of learning and having a learning mindset towards like one's opportunities. And so one can one can just be in one's own lane and like have like love the thrill of an officer role. Or one can like really be there, look back at say email archives, like digital archives, like physical things like we've been showing you today, and say like what was there in the past. And then really looking forward and saying, what can I do in the future? And looking at like things beyond ASU, so things like leadership books, like journalism, things like that. So for this panel, I prepared a Google document that has action steps with like various different leadership books, Asian American resources, podcasts, several cool blog articles, and then like an upgraded version of our Asian American UF timeline. This will be posted in the Alumni Weekend Facebook page tonight. So please take a look at that and at least follow up by like reading, like watching one of the podcasts, like watching like the Asian American Studies sit-in at Tufts University, like that video, watching Michael like give like amazing insight on an Asian American students panel. Like listen to Phillip's like Asian American story, like listen to Karen Mia talking about the Asian American Studies minor, right? So there's so many different resources that like I've like tried to compile in that list. So please do me a favor and take a look at that. Nothing is gonna happen if you just go ahead and like just sit here and then you're like, okay, cool, and then like you like nothing happens the next day. You have to take some type of small incremental action. Like was said, a small action is gonna immediately go into something. Like you have to take some type of small incremental action over a short amount of time, and then it's going to turn into a giant like mountain, right?
That was a seed blossom.
Seeds. Yes. Well,
can you please give our panelists like another loud?
Was that the end?
I think, you know, well, this room is going to be open until, like,
open mic time.
Open mic time. And I want to make sure you all are okay and you all are still have some energy going. See if we can take maybe one question from the audience.
Yeah, let's take some questions.
Okay. All right. So they are open for questions.
So I guess one question that I have, I think something that a theme that I've seen in terms of, like very successful campaigns, it's like that was university-wide. Like you talked to Megan, you talked about being president, the HSC president, and coalition building. I was wondering, like, how did y'all, if there are any instances where you did it not only like across other like student organizations or instead, but like with the local community. So like for instance, the No Nazis at UF protests in response to Richard Spencer, it was very much led by like the activist community here. And like as an Asian American person, it was interesting to like kind of integrate myself in that space. So I guess like, I don't know, I'm interested to see your thoughts of like how you collaborated with other people that weren't Asian American, how you kind of coalition built, or how you kind of reached out to the local community.
This one's got your name written all over it.
Well, we started, I mean, I think for us, and when we first started, some of it was just the basics of how the organization, and so we thought about those things, but most of it was really connecting with our faculty at the time. So I think, yeah, we weren't doing much connections with the local community, but coalition building among student communities, I think, you know, I think you said the ebbs and flows. I think my year was kind of the year after 10 years, we were kind of really reinvigorated. So kind of, I think it really just went upwards since 2003. Very fortunate for us to have that history. But yeah, so much for me around coalition building is really building relationships. I think we set the foundations to build relationships is really what I did. And I think I'll speak to that a little bit from my work perspective of doing local organizing work. Yeah, I think it's really building connections with the different organizations that existed. Yeah. But again, I think during my leadership, we were just trying to survive, figure out what is ASU, and let's not make it ASU, let's make it AASU, you know. Yeah. So I think as I hear about you all's experience, and some of it I think is a fortunate, right, what we were able to establish so that we can keep building, right? Yeah. So you guys weren't fighting the same battles I was, and that's the idea, right? Because if you were, we would have been regressing, right? So you were fighting different battles. So I think for me individually, it was really coalition building sits with finding commonalities in other communities, right? So and then as you and I shared earlier, what does it look like to enter spaces of people who don't look like us but find some commonality? I think that's key as I think about the educator I am now and working with a variety of student communities as they connect back to the community. That's really important to explore. So.
Sure. I was also in FIMU, which was just a regular Pan-Hellenic sorority, which kind of helped broaden my like interaction sort of, because it was all ASU stuff, and you know HSA, BSU, and LGBTQ stuff. It was helpful to go to Gatorship. I don't know if you had Gatorship then too.
Yeah, we were the first class.
Yeah, Gatorship was also a good place to kind of coalition build. I studied abroad in Ireland, which was awesome, and you know, met a bunch of people through that, and they wound up being very politically active in another party as well, and then they were also politically active for, like, you know, when Obama was running and everything. It was actually purely just, like, social reasons. Like, the HSA president and I were in, like, a bunch of political science classes together. I also had a huge crush on him. That helped. or it hurt. I don't know. it hurt me. sorry, we're going too back far back into college. Anyway, moving
it,
on. Moving on. Moving on. Moving on. I'm over it. I just drank a lot of beer, guys. I don't know. just be open to, like, hanging out with people. Yeah. Open to hanging out with people, and don't think about how different you are. Think about how, like, I mean, yes, you're different, but think about how beautiful, like, the differences are. That's why diversity is awesome. Each person in this room, even though, like, you know, yeah, we're Asian American, but, like, we are all very different people. We all bring very different things to the table, and that's freaking beautiful. Yeah. And just, you can relate to anybody. I mean, we're all human, and it's really easy to relate to people if you kind of think down to that kind of more basic level.
I think it comes down to two things. It's relationship building, and it's communication, and being able to communicate with people in a real way. And so what I mean by that is, when I was a treasurer with Megan, that's when there was, like, a Japanese earthquake. And so became involved with Hope for Japan, which was, like, across grad students, international, undergrads, local community. It was this big effort to, like, raise money. And we raised thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars. And it was incredible. We would go and speak in front of, like, Visa events. People would donate money in a bucket. We had so much money in the bucket that we actually thought we needed police escorts because we're just carrying tons of cash around. But what it taught me was, hey, like, it just reaffirmed the fact that we can do a lot of really concrete, tangible things if we work together. And I think what it comes down to is there's always going to be unpredictable crises that come up when you're leading the organization. And if you haven't built those relationships either internally or externally before then, it's a lot harder to ask for people to come help and support and get involved when there's an issue. It's a lot easier when you've already established those relationships and networks and you have friends you can call on who can bring their friends. And the second thing is, where the communication part comes in, is, yeah, we talk about all these things that, you know, on any given day, and as someone who once slept, ate, drank, breathed, lived ASU almost 24/7 to the point where it's probably not that much fun to be around. Because I'd always be like, oh, let's talk about the future. hey, you got me. But the point is, it's like, hey, you know, it's the old rule that 20% of the people are going to do 80% of the work. And yeah, and it's great that, you know, we want certain things. You probably have a certain set of goals or things that, like, people know we want to get done. But for the average person who either doesn't go to ASU and only shows up at ASA or is only interested in dance or sports or whatever, and that's perfectly fine, they should at least have a cursory understanding of what we're doing and why we think it's important. And that comes down to communication. So it's easy to get, like, frustrated and be like, man, no one cares about this stuff except me. I'm, like, shouldering everything. It's much harder but much more productive to figure out a way to, like, break it down to a level that everyone's going to relate to, understand why it's important, and that's how you get more folks in. And that's the most critical thing of how we push things forward, is by having strong networks both within ASU and outside of it. And part of it's also having a long view, because it'd be a shame if I knew that 10 years before me, people were arguing about who was going to get what date on a calendar, or people had e-board drama, or people were burned out, or they felt like they weren't being heard, or they felt like there was tension between certain organizations, or people who were part of certain organizations or not. And it would be a darn shame if that's the same problem 10 years later. And as we look at what we want ASU to be like 25 years from now, I think now's the time to get together, talk about it, hash it out, and each of you has a stake in that. My last thought is that ASU is a, I think of ASU is like a book. It's like a story. And each of us sort of like had either chapters or sections of that story that are really personal to us, but we were just characters. Like, we were there for a minute and we were gone. And the rest of the book still has a lot of blank pages, and it's up to you to write it. We're just history.
I want to go to the story analogy that Michael discovered and really add a few things. So just as you go back in a story, you should, like, a good reader goes back, they underline things, they take notes, they ask questions. The same way, go back, underline certain great things that, say, Lynn did, like, great things that, like, Philip did, and say, like, ask questions. Why did they do that? The cool thing is the characters are here in life, so you can go ahead and, like, Facebook message them or ask them, and then use that, and with the blank pages that Michael described, you can write something, even if it's a full paragraph, or like a small sentence that means something and it's gonna give something forward. Let me give you an example. Really understanding that, like, ASU has been a space where we wanted to make sure that those who identify as LGBTQ+ feel included and inclusive. That was something that a pattern I noticed and a number of board members noticed, like, in the past, and that's dated to, like, quite far. And so when I was EVP and president, we really thought about that, and API Affairs was also involved. So when I was EVP and Campus Awareness Coordinator, we brought Gina Rosero, who is a trans woman of color, Filipina, who went ahead and shared her story. And what's really important was that we also arranged to have, with Women's History Month, and we had small group sessions where she would personally talk to anyone that identified as API and or like a queer and or trans person of color, and have, like, personal, small, like, group reflection time with her. That was a big event. She spoke on stage and awed many people, but she also had that really personal time with individuals who may not feel comfortable in that space and had that time to really connect with her. And then, like, when I was president, we had Gator Allies come in and do a training about, like Gator Allies for Asian Americans. And that was a small thing that was kind of not visible and out there in the front doors, but that really, like, at least changed people's views on, like, what it means to be LGBTQ+. So it goes back to the point of, even if it's, like, a paragraph or a sentence, it's still meaningful to the story. It's still going to bring the story forward. There are plenty of empty pages. The point is to make sure that you are intentionally thinking about, like, the past and what value you as a writer can give to make that story, make that word, make that sentence count. That's the key.
Thank you all so much. It is now 4 o'clock, so we're going to go ahead and respect our panel's time. Please give them another round.
Can we also applaud, I am the current president.
Yeah!
Come to the ASU Museum on Monday. But, no, honestly, thank you all so much for coming back into town and sharing your stories with us. I know it's not easy to get to Gainesville, but we really do appreciate it. And so we're going to play some light music. We do have this room if anyone wants to sit. Our panelists, you know, they do need some time to rest and breathe and everything, but, you know.
I never rest.
True story.
But take some time. We hope that you've also enjoyed ASU Week. Closing ceremony is tomorrow, and if any of our alumni friends are still in town, we'd love to have you. We'll just have a table for you.
Wait, so who's running for ASU board?
Wait, can we get a picture?
Wow.
Let's get a picture.
That's a little question. Before we go, can we all get, like, a group picture?
I can go recruit.
Okay, go over
here. Group picture, then panelist picture, then board picture. It's going to be pictures upon pictures.
In the back. Face the back?
He does.
Well, can I interview you then?
Probably I'm going to stay here.
Okay.
Henry's camera
still has batteries.
He's asking for
back in the day.
Oh, yes. Oh, my gosh. Anyway, you
that's a good one.
This is all.